Je rappelle Monsieur Sébastien Kaufmann,
s'il vous plaît.
Thank you.
Merci.
Well, my paper is in English, but I am not a native speaker, so I will talk very slow. So I assume that for you that are more French, are familiar with French, will be easy to follow. A political recognition can be described as a normative proposal addressed to the political community that contains different kinds of policies that are aimed toward the construction of a society where the subjects or the groups can feel recognized. The specific contents of those policies and the meaning of such recognition will depend on the theory that serves as the foundation for a politics of recognition. Ricoeur does not propose a political recognition. Instead, he offers us a theory of recognition that could eventually serve as the foundation for a politics of recognition. In this paper, I will examine whether it is possible to build a politics of recognition from Ricoeur's theory of recognition and the possibilities and the limit of such politics. In order to do that, it's important to come up with a framework that shows us how a politic of recognition works. Charles Taylor's politic of recognition can be considered canonical in the sense that today we almost identify the project of a politics of recognition with his article that has, as you know, the same name. It would be helpful then to take a look to Charles Taylor's politics of recognition in order to identify a possible structures of such project. Once we have done that, we can wonder whether it is possible to construct a politics of recognition in Ricoeur and whether such politics of recognition would have any advantage over Taylor's one. A way of approaching Taylor's political recognition is identifying in his project three moments. First, an anthropological foundation. Second, a normative framework. And third, a political claim. Taylor offers as a foundation for his politics of recognition an anthropological account that shows us how our self is constructed through the mediation of others. Our self-image depends heavily on how we are perceived by others, or to be more precise, on how we think that others see us. Thus, our identity and self-esteem is constructed through others. Recognition, in this sense, happens when others perceive our value and dignity, and is denied when we receive from others a distortive or demeaning image of ourselves. A quote from Taylor: "The thesis that our identity is partly shaped by recognition or its absence, often by misrecognition of others, and so a person or group of people can suffer real damage, real distortion, if the people or society around them mirror back to them a confining or demeaning or contemptible picture of them," end quote. For Taylor, the, quote, "crucial feature of human life, it is fundamentally dialogical character," end quote. Because of this feature, others are fundamental in the construction of our identity. However, this not only happens at the personal level. At the social level, we find that the identities of groups are also formed through the mediation of others. Then, a demeaning image of a group hurts the self-image of the members of that group. This point is crucial for a politics of recognition, as we will see. So if a complete group is badly seen in a society, of course that will affect the specific member of that group. Taylor does not only offer an anthropological description of the dialogical nature of human beings that affects the way in which our self-image is constructed, but it also offers a normative framework that basically states that human beings, because their dignity, deserve to be recognized. So it's not just the fact that we construct our identity through others, but he thinks that it's a right to have a good sense of ourselves through the recognition of others. So, quote from Taylor, within this perspective, misrecognition shows us not just a lack of due respect. It can inflict a grievous wound, saddling its victim with crippling self-hatred. Due recognition is not just a courtesy we owe people, it is a vital human need, end quote. Finally, from the anthropological and normative account, we move to the political claims of a politics of recognition. Societies cannot do much with respect to recognition at a personal level. However, they have a crucial role in order to assure individuals that they can live in a culture that is respected, appreciated, and that survives through times. Then, what society should provide are a kind of cultural rights to specific culture. So, of course, society cannot improve my self-image in a personal level, but society can recognize my own culture, and through that, I can feel recognized in a personal level. Then, what society should provide are, as I said, a kind of cultural right to specific cultures. Taylor is thinking mainly in Quebec cultures. Quebecois need to count with a culture in which they can feel recognized. So societies cannot be neutral, and they need to take specific political measures that assure the survival of certain cultures through times, such as the obligation for certain groups of educating their sons and daughters in schools where they can learn their own language, for example. Also, it should imply some measures in order to make possible that some cultures can be valued by a society. It is not possible to impose a positive view on a culture, but societies should take some measure that can give us the opportunity to know specific cultures, to overcome some prejudices, and eventually to learn to appreciate them. So, of course, I cannot be forced to have a positive image of a group. However, the media, the newspaper, the programs in the schools can show that cultures, can show me that cultures in a good way or in a fair way, so I can learn to appreciate that specific culture. These political measures go in a different direction than liberalism, as of course we can imagine. While liberalism promotes an equal treatment of all and the respect for all individual choices, Taylor's politics of recognition promote specific political measures directed to a specific group that can eventually restrict some individual rights, such as the right to choose the education that we want to give to our children. So there's a discussion in Canada that Quebecois need to send their kids to French school. That, of course, for liberalism, is not good. So the idea of collective rights arises here as the right of some cultures to survive. So the idea of the right of a group emerged here. Well, so far I have proposed to distinguish in Taylor three levels: an anthropological level, where Taylor stresses the dialogical nature of our self-identity and esteem; a normative level, where Taylor affirms that recognition is something that is required; and finally, a political level, where we find specific measures taken by societies in order to assure that human beings count with cultures in which they can feel recognized. Do we find something similar in Ricoeur? Can we distinguish an anthropological level, a normative level, and a political level? It is hard to compare Taylor's account with Ricoeur's one, because we find in Ricoeur a different kind of discourse and project. Ricoeur's course of recognition, more than a philosophical project of a politics of recognition, can be seen as a continuation of the phenomenological project of oneself as another. However, it is my contention, Ricoeur's course of recognition can serve as a foundation for a politic of recognition. In order to show that, I will propose the same framework that I used to explain Taylor's political recognition, so these three levels that I already described. It is well known that Ricoeur developed a semantic approach in the course of recognition where he identifies three types of recognition: recognition as identification, recognition oneself, recognizing oneself, and mutual recognition. For the purpose of this paper, it is more important to focus in the last two, that is, in self-recognition and in mutual recognition. In the idea of self-recognition, we find that we can call the anthropological foundation of recognition. In this second part of the book, Ricoeur presents the phenomenology of the capable human beings. This phenomenology is already present in oneself as another and shows how, in order to develop our selfhood, we need to be able to recognize our own self in our capacities. At the same time, the text shows that that recognition is impossible without the mediation of others, because capacities are fundamental social. In short, the argument is as follows. In order to become ourselves, we need to become agents. Agency is achieved through the recognition of ourselves in our own capacities and actions. We cannot recognize ourselves in our capacities and action without the mediation of the recognition of others. This phenomenological account can be understood in terms of a philosophical anthropology that states that selfhood needs the mediation of others. We become selves through others. In this sense, the phenomenology of the capable being summarizes the hermeneutic of the self, of oneself and as another. The ontological foundation of such phenomenology can be found in the 10th study of oneself as another, What Ontology in View, where Ricoeur shows how our self is formed by a threefold passivity: the passivity of the body, the passivity of others, and the passivity of conscience. The anthropological foundation is not very different from Taylor's account. Taylor's affirms that others are crucial for the formation of our own identities. Ricoeur makes the same point in the 6th study of oneself as another, where he develops the idea of narrative identity. The same thesis is found in Ricoeur's analysis of the ethical aim. For both anthropologists, Taylor and Ricoeur, others are crucial for the configuration of our identity and of our self-esteem. Both anthropologists are dialogical, and for both it is crucial the role of others for the configuration of a good sense of ourself. Now, the normative level. Ricoeur phenomenological account has important normative implication. In his phenomenology, it's hard to distinguish the phenomenological claim from the normative claim. For example, when Ricoeur describes the ethical aim as aiming at the good life with and for other in just institution, we can see that this phenomenological account of our basic ethical desire is strongly normative. Ricoeur affirms in relation to narratives that narration always entail a normative dimension. Either in the act of narrator or in the act of reading, we cannot completely suspend our idea of the good and the bad. And this famous quote, "The thought experiment we conduct in the great laboratory of the imaginary also are exploration in the realm of the good and the evil." End quote. For this and other reasons, Ricoeur rejects the dichotomy between describing and prescribing. Thus, the idea of that we construct our identity through the recognition of others and the idea that we become capable thanks to the recognition of our capacities from others is not only a phenomenological claim, but also is a normative claim in the sense that we should get such recognition. It is something desirable, something good, as Ricoeur himself affirms. So now I move to the central part of the paper, that is the possibility of a political recognition in Ricoeur. So far, we have found in Ricoeur a proposal that is not as different from Taylor's one. In both cases, we have an anthropological foundation, and in both cases, a normative claim. However, we find important difference in the fact that Ricoeur does not develop explicitly a politics of recognition, whereas Taylor's proposal is mainly a politic of recognition. It is possible to propose a political recognition from Ricoeur's theory of recognition. I think that it is possible if we connect recognition and the symbolic dimension of action. Before going deeper in that connection, I will briefly present the idea of that symbolic dimension of action. The inscription of our action in a symbolic order is a condition for the development of all human capacities. For example, in Time and Narrative, by describing the triple mimesis, he affirms that the poetic composition is grounded in a, quote, pre-understanding of the world of action, its meaningful structures, its symbolic resources, and its temporal character, end quote. These three aspects of action, semantic, symbolic, and temporal, are indeed the structural features of human action. The plot, insofar imitate action, identify structures that are already there. If we need the competence of identifying action in its symbolic natures in order to imitate action through narration, even more is necessary such competence in order to act. The symbolic order refers to the articulation in signs, rules, and norms that is proper of human action. Because the symbolic structure, I can interpret a movement as a specific action, as Ricoeur affirmed in this famous quote, so the same gesture of raising our one's arm, depending on the context, may be understood as a way of greeting, a hailing a taxi or boat, end quote. Then it makes sense to affirm that the agent, in order to act, needs what we can call a symbolic competence, that is, the ability of managing the symbolic dimension of human action. It would seem evident that we need this kind of competence or ability in order to act meaningfully. What is interesting is that it is possible to acquire imperfectly this competence, or at least to participate imperfectly in this competence in some context. So we need to manage, we have to need some symbolic competence. We need to understand the symbolic structure of a culture in order to act meaningfully. My point, and Ricoeur's point, of course, is that this capacity can be fully developed or can be developed imperfectly. So some people in some societies are not able to manage completely this symbolic dimension. Okay? So, for example, Ricoeur gives the example of language. Not all of us, we participate in the same level in the dominion of language, in the realm of language. So, for example, some people can feel isolated in a society because of his or her imperfect participation in language. Also, he gives the example of the capacity of being imputable. So, some people in some tribunal, in some trial, they can have a hard time to recognize what they have done because they don't manage the symbolic dimension of some action that allow them to recognize that they did somebody, that and now they have to pay the consequences. Okay, so even that basic capacity of recognizing what I have done not always is completely shared. So there's a dissymmetry in our participation in this symbolic order. So, and of course, that depends heavily of the society. So the societies should give us the capacity of fully participating in this symbolic order. So this attitude from society of giving the necessary symbolic resources, either allowing others to participate in the main symbolic forms, or either trying to accept and understand the symbolic code of some groups, can be called the symbolic hospitality, to rephrase the idea of linguistic hospitality. So Ricoeur, in the paradigm of translation, defines linguistic hospitality as the ethical attitude that is required in order to have the willingness of conducting the author to the reader and the reader to the author, allowing the foreign to be said in my own language and allowing my own ideas to be said in a foreign language. The translator is the responsible of this task, and it supposes basic openness to the foreign, to not be enclosed in what is mine, in mine. Ricoeur extends the idea, this idea also to things in the necessary openness of tradition and religion. The symbolic hospitality, in my opinion, is a concrete way of applying the idea of recognition to politics. It entails the willingness of a symbolic system that is part of a tradition to be open to other cultures and forms of life as a way of allowing them to count with the symbolic resources that they need to express themselves. We well know that in societies there are dominant cultures and marginal ones. Part of the symbolic hospitality would consist to allow the marginal cultures to find the symbolic resources to express themselves, what will allow people to articulate meaningfully their action. So then I give three examples of this symbolic. So my point is, a way of recognition is to give to people the symbolic resources in order to allow them to articulate their own action, to act meaningfully. And that willingness I call symbolic hospitality, rephrasing what Ricoeur called in the paradigm of translation this linguistic hospitality. Okay, so three examples, concrete examples, could be to give to specific group the possibility of narrate their own stories. So that is a kind of participation in a symbolic orders. We know that always some stories are prevalent and other are marginal. So to have hospitality toward those stories. A second example is the participation of the public realm. That also is a way of allowing other symbolic system to be said in my own, in the mainstream symbolic system of the public sphere. And a third example that I give is the capacity of articulating collective memories. So if a group is not able to articulate their own memories in the public sphere, they will not be able to fully develop their symbolic capacity. So I need to feel that my own memories, the stories of my own country and my own people, can be expressed and can count and are remembered by the society in which I live. Well, we know many examples of denial in Europe, no? So I will not go there. It is this proposal different from Taylor's? Which advantage it would be have? In both cases, recognition has to do with the fact that our identities cannot be constructed without the mediation of others, and with the fact that if there is not a positive perception from some groups, then self-esteem can seriously be damaged. However, one possible advantage of Ricoeur approach over Taylor's one is to link, to connect recognition not just with a positive self-image of an individual or a group, but with the whole construction of the self. Along the same line, for Ricoeur, the lack of recognition could not only damage our sense of ourself, but also could impede our action, since recognition is strongly linked with the idea of capacities. Without the recognition of our capacities, capacity cannot be developed. So my point is, Ricoeur is stronger in the idea of recognition, since for Taylor, recognition is a matter of having a good self, a good sense of ourself, a good identity. For Ricoeur, recognition is crucial in order to construct ourself. So without recognition, could not be a self. For Ricoeur, with misrecognition, would be a self, but a damaged self. So Ricoeur connect recognition with the idea of the capacity to act. So for me, it's a stronger claim. Well, I will go to the conclusion. So far, I have tried to show the connection between recognition and symbolic hospitality, particularly in relation with Taylor's political recognition. I have affirmed that without a symbolic order that I can count with, it is impossible to fully develop our capacities. So the recognition of the capacities seems to demand measures that permit that a symbolic order be ready and available to the agents. I know that by taking this path, I have narrowed down Ricoeur's theory of recognition to a singular aspect, the recognition of capacity that is mentioned in the second part of course of recognition. It is time to bring to the discussion an important part of recurse theory of recognition that is developed in the third part of the course of recognition, the relation of recognition with the symbolic exchange of gifts. Ricœur discusses the idea of exchange of gifts in order to show that although reciprocity is an important aspect of recognition, it should also at the same time go beyond the logic of giving in order to receive something in return, the do ut des. So Ricœur showed the idea of exchange of gift can be a symbolic model of recognition if we interpret that exchange of gift not just I give you a gift, you give me a gift because you feel the obligation, because obligated because I give you one, but you give me back a gift because you recognize me. So that is Ricœur's proposal. So I am here in my last page. So through the idea of the symbolic value of the exchange of gifts, we overcome mere reciprocity where each one can be replaced and we move toward the construction of mutuality, a space where we cannot just be replaced because we have a specific value that is recognized, where we have value and not price, following Kant, no? So you know, for Ricœur, the idea of mutuality is central there. This space of mutuality, again, can be interpreted by the symbolic hospitality. That is a space where we are open to other symbolic system and we allow them to transform us. Surprisingly, here we come closer to Taylor's proposal of using Gadamer's idea of fusion of horizons to think the recognition between cultures. Taylor proposes the Gadamerian idea of fusion of horizon as a way of overcoming the ethnocentrism of just using our own values to measure other cultures. By the fusion of horizons, we let other cultures to affect our criteria of judgment. It is not relativism, but an enrichment of our own parochial point of view. So the idea of Taylor is if two cultures are encountered, we should not just using our own measures to judge others, but our own criteria of judgment should be transformed by that other culture. Thus, what Taylor calls fusion of horizon following Gadamer, in my opinion, can be reformulated as a symbolic hospitality, with advantage that is more precise in what exactly should come together in that fusion. So in Gadamer, well, it's a fusion of horizon, of perspective, but if we interpret that fusion of horizon as symbolic hospitality, what really must be come together in that fusion is the symbolic dimension of both cultures. So I think that idea of symbolic hospitality will add an ethical dimension of receiving, and also is more specific in pointing out to the idea of the symbolic structure of both cultures must be transformed in that encounter. By this surprising encounter between the idea of fusion of horizon and the idea of symbolic hospitality, we realize that at the end, Taylor and Ricœur proposal on recognition are similar. The main difference is that one starts from a phenomenological account of the constitution of the self, and the other from a political proposal in the context of multiculturalism. By putting them together, Taylor's proposal gains phenomenological depth, and Ricœur's theory gains political impact. Thank you.
Merci.
Merci.
Sébastien Coffin, je donne la parole.
Oui. Okay. Thank you, Sébastien. I like very much what you said. I think we're working on similar topics, so there could be a good exchange. I'm just going to ask you a small question and give you a suggestion. I don't know if you've read, there's a very recent article by Charles Taylor from last year that is called multiculturalism or interculturalism.
No.
Okay, but I can send it to you afterwards. Where it comes back to the original argument from examining the politics of recognition, but to distinguish two similar models with slight differences, the multicultural and the intercultural. And he's defending the multicultural model because it focuses more on the recognition of diversity, whereas the intercultural model focuses more on integration and protecting identities in order that they don't disappear, let's mm-hmm. say. So I like very much your notion of symbolic hospitality. My only question would be, what happens when, even though symbolic transformation is necessary, the majority of society does not want that to happen? So what happens in societies where there are historically discriminated against, disenfranchised groups who lack recognition, and where the symbolic transformation does not take place because there are, for example, structures of power that are ideological in recurrent sense, and so the only way to take into account the need for change is for social actors to actively, you know, try to narrate differently and try to acquire the capabilities that they need in order to overcome misrecognition. You know, so I wonder if what you said about symbolic hospitality could be complemented by also taking into account social conflict.
Thank you, Gonzalo. I appreciate your comment because I think that this approach, for example, we have to complement with Honneth's idea of the struggle for recognition. Because, of course, even symbolic hospitality is an ethical attitude will not come just because we are good people. No? It supposes conflict, it supposes struggle, but always with an ethical aim, as Ricoeur stresses against Hobbes. And also because it's a politics of recognition, it supposes power. So we will not wait until people decide to recognize themselves, but the state, and this is the anti-liberal taste of this political recognition, will have to take measures, and some of those measures, of course, will not be appreciated by everyone. So that is how I agree with you, that the idea of conflict and the struggle, and of course, has to be taken into consideration here. So thank you.
On a le temps juste pour une dernière question. On aura besoin de la salle après. Patricia, s'il vous plaît.
Thank you very much for your exposition. So I just have some questions. I think that what concerns the anthropological niveau, Ricoeur and Taylor are closer, mm-hmm. as you presented them, because also for Taylor, if you consider sources of the self, the institution of meanings are conditions of the development of human agency as a strong evaluator. So I don't see a very strong difference between Taylor and Ricoeur on this side. Mm-hmm. On the contrary, I see a difference perhaps, but I'm not sure, on the ontological level, because I have the impression that Taylor accords to institutional meanings a ontological status different from that stronger as from Ricoeur. I see by Ricoeur hesitations according to, for example, language also, institutional meanings, a stronger ontological status. So, and I think that this difference could be also key to explicate the difference on political niveau that you didn't stress, so that Ricoeur doesn't arrive to accord to cultural communities the rights over the rights of individuals. So I don't know
that. Oh, yes, thank you. No, I don't know in depth the ontology of Taylor, but it seems that you are right that Ricoeur does not develop a strong kind of ontology of communities or ontology of cultures or ontology of language from language itself. And in that sense, it seems that Taylor is much stronger in that point. And on the other side, Ricoeur is stronger in the constitution of the self through others, especially in oneself as another. So for me, a way of complement is I think that Taylor adds more depth in ontological reflection on the communal, and Ricoeur adds more depth on the ontological reflection on the constitution of the self. So thank you.